Hello and welcome, retailers and manufacturers, again to day three of our TP Ignite online educational series. My name is Ben Stimson, Senior Director for TMG Media. Today's session is titled The State of the Cigar Industry. Now, public policy is critical to the cigar industry. David Ozgo, President of Cigar Association of America, and Chris Newbry, Vice President of Government Affairs, will give an overview of the challenges the industry has faced, both at a state and federal level in 2022, and also discuss the likelihood of potential tax increases and proposed flavor bans that we'll face in 2022. Now, David Ozgo is new president of Cigar Association, and we welcome him to CAA. Prior to joining CAA, he was a senior vice president and chief economist at Distilled Spirits Council, Discus, where he served for over 20 years. Mr. Ozgo has been part of several highly successful public policy campaigns. At Discus, he analyzed market trends and presented a widely anticipated industry review each year to Wall Street analysts and writers that covered the liquor industry. Chris Newbry is Vice President of Government Affairs for the Cigar Association of America. And Chris has more than 20 years of experience in state and local government affairs, where he's been representing and working on CAA issues across all 50 states the last decade. Chris has a tremendously high success rate for defending the cigar and pipe industry from ruinous tax increases, product sale bans, and other industry-killing measures. Chris is passionate about protecting the rights of adults who choose to enjoy cigars and spend roughly 200 days on the road in that effort. Guys, welcome. I'm going to introduce now David and Chris, who joined us last year, and this year they're back. David, how are you? Nice to see you.
I'm just fine, Ben. It's good to be here.
Good to speak to you. And how is the new appointment here? And congratulations on joining CAA. How are you finding it?
I have to say it's absolutely wonderful. You know, when I first accepted the position, I had a lot of friends that said, gosh, how can you leave liquor? But I have to tell you, cigars are a lot of fun too, and I've had a very, very warm welcome. So it's been great so far.
That's great. Now, where are you in Washington right now?
We're actually in Washington, D.C., yes.
And for those that are sitting in Florida in 72-degree weather, how cold is it where you are?
It was, I believe, 24 degrees when I left the house this morning. As you can tell, I'm actually sitting in my office wearing a sweater because it is that cold with these windows behind me. So it is chilly here. I'm envious of those of you that are in Florida.
Me too. It was 27 here as well, at least around about that temperature in North Carolina. David, I'm not going to take any more time. I'm going to hand it over to you, and then we're going to have Chris do a presentation as well. So David, without any further ado, over to you.
Great. Thank you so much, Ben. Chris will be talking about the states and what's going on there, and I'll give you a recap at the federal level and what we anticipate in 2022. So obviously at the federal level, I thought the audience is probably going to be interested in two things. One, are there any plans to raise tobacco taxes, cigar taxes in 2022? Secondly, just what is going on with the Food and Drug Administration? So as I'm sure everybody is aware, in 2021, as part of the Biden administration's original Build Back Better plan, there was a nicotine tax component to that. Among other things, it would have substantially increased the excise tax rate on premium cigars. Obviously, cigarette taxes would have been doubled, and for the first time ever, there would have been a tax on vaping products. Now, fortunately, largely due to the efforts of my predecessor, Craig Williams, and the Cigar Association, and many, many others throughout the tobacco industry, we were able to get that tax removed. However, I have to say, the proponents of a nicotine tax are not going away. They're going to look for any opportunity that they can to reinstate that tax. Let me first address for a few minutes what the risk is in 2022 of that tax coming back. Now, first, the good news. Having put forth such an effort in 2021 to have the tax removed, those meetings that we had with congressional staff, with congressmen, senators, are going to be fresh in everyone's minds. You had those meetings, you got their talking points across, we made our point, and we got the tax removed. So with those conversations fresh in everyone's mind, that will, shall I say, vaccinate us to a certain extent against excise tax increases at the federal level. Now, additionally, 2022 is an election year, and even on so-called sin taxes, legislators don't like to raise taxes during an election year. So on the surface, that should make us relatively safe. But of course, this is Washington, D.C., and you're never completely safe. So the Build Back Better plan was extremely bold, particularly in a Senate that split 50-50, and that would require every single Democratic senator to vote in favor of it. It started off with a price tag of over $5 trillion over 10 years. It's now been reduced fairly substantially to about $1.8 billion, or trillion dollars rather, over 10 years. But that's still a fairly large increase in expenditures. The problem with a bold plan is that they needed every single vote to get it through the Senate. And it's been well documented. There are two senators, Manchin and Sinema, who objected to the Build Back Better plan. And just before Christmas, in fact, Senator Manchin said that he felt that the plan was dead. Now, you hear various things about whether or not Manchin is engaged in negotiations again or not with the Biden White House. But Manchin's primary concerns were over the cost and what it would do to the deficit. Additionally, what impact it would have on inflation. Now, obviously, inflation was reported again this morning that is up 7%. That's the fastest rate in the last 40 years. So that's still a substantial figure out there. Obviously, that issue is not going away. This all leads me to, okay, what is the potential risk then? Well, while it is doubtful that the Manchin and Biden administrations will reach agreement, if we do have some sort of Build Back Better plan, if there is an agreement, Manchin is going to stick to his guns. He's going to insist that it be paid for somehow. So if you have a Senate, a legislature that needs to pay for a Build Back Better plan, well, then taxes will again be on the table. And let's face it, Build Back Better was really the centerpiece of President Biden's domestic policy. The Democrats are going to want to give him a big win going into an election. So as a result, if we have to pay for that $1.8 trillion in new spending, they're going to be looking for any tax revenue that they can possibly get. The projections for the nicotine tax put it at around a $96 billion in new tax revenue. So that's going to be awfully enticing. Even though we had all those conversations, if the House and Senate feel like they really need to give the president a win, and if they need to find some revenue to offset the $1.8 billion cost, we could potentially be back on the table. Secondly, another area of risk, depending on who you listen to with the coming November elections, Republicans, I've heard people say, might actually win their biggest majority since the 1920s. Senate is a little more iffy if they're willing to, as to whether or not the Republicans will be able to take the Senate. But what that could do, should the Republicans take the Senate, is the Democrats might be looking at a lame duck session where they're going to be in the minority for at least another 2 years. Many of them will be leaving office either because they lost their election or because they're retiring. This could be their last hurrah. And in such a lame duck session, you never know if, believing that this is the last chance to get a priority through, if the nicotine tax might again be on the table. So we face risk in the event that the Biden administration does come to some agreement with Senator Manchin on Build Back Better. And we also face risk in a lame duck session. again, I think to a certain extent, we've been, say, inoculated from tax increases because of what we went through last year. But again, a vaccination eventually wears out. Now, let me talk a little bit about what we're seeing at the Food and Drug Administration. I'm going to be fairly brief here because Tom Bryant of NATO did such an exceptional job just a day or two ago on through TPE. So I'll keep this fairly brief. But first, obviously, Dr. Robert Califf will likely be approved by the Senate Health, Education, Labor, and Pension, or the Help Committee. He might have already been approved. I believe they're actually supposed to vote today. If he does get approved, it's going to be by a very, very narrow vote. It's my understanding the vote is, in fact, fairly close right now. There are Republicans that were disappointed that during the Obama administration, Dr. Califf made it easier to ship abortion pills through the mail. And by the same token, there are Democrats that feel that Dr. Califf is, in fact, a little bit too close to the pharmaceutical industry. So he's getting pushback from either side. Now, should he be approved? Clearly there's a lot more on FDA's plate right now than just tobacco issues. COVID is still going strong, obviously, and the FDA is going to face issues regarding, getting more test kits into the economy, into the U.S. population, approving potential new vaccines, as well as approving potential new protocols for actually treating COVID. Additionally, FDA has taken criticism recently over their handling of the opioid crisis. So there's a lot that's going to be on the new FDA administrator's plate other than just tobacco. But clearly with regard to tobacco, the new FDA administrator, or really the CTP, early on is going to face several potential lawsuits that are pending that might force them to actually act upon the issue of flavored tobacco or rather menthol flavored tobacco. There are several lawsuits. Now, obviously, the CTP has also been criticized over the speed with which they're making decisions on pre-market authorization for a lot of products. So the new administrator is going to face that problem. Now, from the premium cigar, for premium cigars, most have gotten full approval for substantial equivalence. So pre-market authorization is not an issue, but it's something that's going to take the new FDA administrator's time. Now, what can we expect from an administrator, Califf? Well, you never know until somebody's actually in office, even though we did have a little bit of a preview of him during the Obama administration. But I went through and looked at some of the comments that he had previously made, either working at FDA when he was a private citizen or at the various hearings. One of the statements he made is that flavors in vaping products should be banned immediately, and the campaign about the dangers of unregulated vaping should be dramatically increased. Now, in addition to that statement, he also said during one of the hearings that surveillance should be increased to identify individuals and groups that sell to minors. So it's not really clear what he means by surveillance in this instance. When I look at the FDA's retailer compliance checks, the retailers, I have to say, are doing an incredible job. They have a 98% compliance rate, and they had a 98% compliance rate in 2021. While 100% is obviously always the goal, when you start getting to numbers above 98%, you know that, well, look, any non-compliance is not a systemic issue when it comes to selling to underage person, but it's probably just a matter of simple human error. Thus, as to what Dr. Califf will truly means when he says identify individuals and groups that sell to minors, is not exactly known, but I know if he's looking at the FDA compliance rates, what he might want to do, and this would actually be a positive, is to look more at illegal operators and not legal retailers. Now, additionally, he's also stated that he's in favor of Australian-style approach whereby one can only get vaping cartridges through a doctor's prescription. So that might be something to keep an eye out on. Ultimately, we're not really going to know how much CTP might change its direction until Dr. Califf actually selects a new CPT director once Dr. Zeller retires. Anyway, just a few thoughts on the potential risk that we face with regard to new taxes and what we might see from the new FDA and the FDA director. At that, I'm going to turn it over to Chris, where he is going to give us a rundown on what's going on in the States. Chris?
Thank you, David. Thank you, Ben. Thanks for giving us the opportunity to address your audience. We really do appreciate when we get these opportunities to do this. I'm going to give you a quick presentation, maybe 15 minutes, on the state of the states. We're going to cover kind of what has gone on in last year, in 2021, and provide an overview of what we expect going into 2022. You know, during the second year of state legislative sessions conducted under the cloud of COVID-19, CAA was faced with many significant threats to the industry. While pandemic mitigation was a large part of the state's legislative agendas, there was a substantial number of proposals put forth that could have negatively affected the cigar industry as well as pipe tobacco industry. With most state legislatures continuing to conduct business remotely or with restricted access, the CAA government affairs team, even with those challenges, notched significant wins. The following is a summary of the industry positive results achieved through the hard work of CAA and its members. We'll cover four main topics today. They involve excise taxes, flavored tobacco bans and sales bans, online sales excise tax collection, and local government preemption. We'll hit the highlights of 2021 and provide an outlook for 2022. Going into 2021, it was clear that the state tax revenues, while certainly impacted by COVID, were not near as dire as predicted early in the pandemic. Coupled with passage of the American Rescue Plan Act in March, which distributed substantial financial assistance to the states, it was thought that proposals to raise tobacco taxes in order to close budget gaps would not materialize. Nothing could have been further from the truth. Instead, we encountered 16 states that considered raising excise taxes on tobacco, including cigars and pipe. Large cigars, little cigars, and pipe tobacco. Those states were Georgia, Hawaii, listed here above. By the conclusion of the state sessions, though, CAA, along with our other industry partners, were able to defeat every single one of the tax proposals that were under consideration. An outstanding result, certainly. In 2021, we continued to defend existing tax caps on cigars. You know, in many states, we have caps on how much the tax can be levied on cigars. We were tasked with protecting the caps in Michigan, Minnesota, and Rhode Island, and we were able to get a tax cap of 30 cents passed in North Carolina. Bills were introduced in 18 states that would have banned and restricted the sale of certain cigars and pipe tobacco products. These include flavor bans, remote sales bans, pharmacy sales bans, and various other restrictions. Bills were considered, as I mentioned earlier, in 18 states. Listed on the screen. And we're happy to report that at the conclusion of the 2021 state legislative sessions, we were able to defeat every single one of the flavor ban proposals. Another outstanding result. Online sales tax collection. In the last 2 years, there's been increased efforts by states to extend tobacco excise taxes to remote sellers of cigars and pipe tobacco. In response to this pressure, CAA has partnered with the Premium Cigar Coalition to work with states to advance legislation that provides the legal framework necessary for remote sellers to become tax compliant. Maryland now serves as a model by which other states can and should follow if they choose to pursue this tax policy. By the end of the year, we had a bill passed in North Carolina as well, becoming the second state to adopt similar legislation. CAA and PCC continuing this effort, we also engaged in South Dakota, where we worked to lift the prohibition on the remote sale of cigars and pipe tobacco. We're also engaged in the state of Utah that remains the last state to prohibit the remote sale of cigars and pipe tobacco. And we will, at this point, be pursuing legislation in both Indiana, Colorado, Michigan, Virginia, and Utah, with certainly states potentially to be added as the legislative sessions go on. Local government preemption, another issue important to the industry. CA and our industry partners succeeded in passing legislation in Florida that preempted local governments from regulating the sale and marketing of tobacco products. This is important, you know, as Tom Bryant mentioned in his presentation a couple of days ago, that the fight, especially when it comes to flavored tobacco bans, has been taken to the local level. And in states that do the right thing, in our opinion, and regulate tobacco at the statewide level, there are efforts constantly underway to lift that preemption to allow local governments, cities and counties, to ban the sale of tobacco, restrict sales, and so on and so forth. In Kentucky, Maryland, and Rhode Island, we had to defend against those exact threats to lifting preemption. We expect problems in this arena going forward into the new year, into 2022. And it's a big issue for the industry. Highlights from 2021. As I mentioned earlier, Minnesota, we needed to successfully defend the tax cap in Minnesota. There was a proposal to increase the cap to $5 from 50 cents. It was absolutely ridiculous. It was ruinous to the industry, both, you know, to all taxpayers and to the cigar consumer. And it seems to be an exercise that we need to go through annually defending what we have in Minnesota. Rhode Island as well, annually. We are constantly under threat to increase the tax cap for purely punitive reasons in Rhode Island. So we had to defend those. Michigan, in order to get a tax cap many, many years ago, they put a sunset in place that every few years required the legislature to review the issue and decide whether to extend the tax cap on cigars. That legislation, that piece of statute was supposed to expire on November 1st of 2021. Without removing that sunset, the tax rate would have reverted back to a 32% wholesale rate on cigars. We were able to get that bill passed. The tax cap remained the same at 50 cents. Retailers, consumers were not harmed. It was a great result. As I mentioned again, North Carolina, as part of the efforts between CAA and the Pipe, the Premium Cigar Coalition, in our efforts with the online excise tax issue, we're able to negotiate a 30 cent tax cap on cigars that was ultimately adopted in the budget bill by the legislature. Nevada, we successfully defended in preventing really awful, onerous, and burdensome customer data collection requirements on remote sellers of cigars and pipe tobacco from a Nevada Attorney General supported bill. It was one of the most aggressive we'd had proposed in the country and took a great deal of work to get that issue resolved in Nevada. Arkansas, we were approached by a brick and mortar retailer in Arkansas early in the year who had an issue with not being able to sell product to his customers remotely, which presented a huge barrier to keeping his business open, especially during the shutdowns from the pandemic. We engaged on that retailer's behalf with the Arkansas legislature, and were able to pass legislation that lifted the prohibition for an in-state cigar retailer to sell to his customers remotely. And that was a real great win for small business in Arkansas. Florida, while both of these bills didn't pass, what was nice that we were able to get in that was an exemption from cigar and pipe smoking from a bill that would have banned smoking on beaches and public parks. You know, a lot of people choose to go to the beach. If you want to go smoke a cigar and sit at the beach, you really should be able to, especially in the state of Florida. And again, like I said, while those bills didn't pass, we did secure the necessary exemptions for cigar consumers and pipe consumers to be able to enjoy their products and in an outdoor setting. The outlook for 2022, I think that we can expect to face many of the same challenges as we did from 2021. You know, the states are flush with money, but it doesn't mean that they don't consider tobacco taxes to be low-hanging fruit. And so, you know, we're barely a week into sessions already, and there's some particularly aggressive bills in Kentucky and both New Mexico that are massive tax hikes across the entire category of tobacco, including cigars and pipe. New Mexico, for example, just 2 years ago, we secured a tax cap on cigars in New Mexico. The current bill that's been introduced removes that cap and triples the rate, along with tripling the rate with pipe tobacco, doubling the rate on cigarettes, and so on and so forth. Flavored tobacco bans at both the state and local level. We're going to be continuing to face those issues. We had an all-out knockdown, drag-out fight in the state of Maine last year. When we defeated them in the state house in Maine, they began to go to the local level, to Portland and Bangor, Maine, first, to get flavor bans passed at the local level to show, you know, a grassroots support for a statewide ban. So sales restrictions, again, you know, pharmacy bans, telling retailers what they must carry on their shelves. In New Jersey, there's a bill that was introduced last year that's a carryover that requires retailers of tobacconists to also carry retailers of tobacco to also carry cessation products, telling retailers what they must put on their shelves. And again, as I mentioned earlier, efforts to lift local preemption. There's already been a bill filed in Maryland, and it's got a hearing at the end of the month. Along with that, CA will continue in its efforts on behalf of the Premium Cigar Coalition to, again, continue to address the online excise tax collection project that we've been working on for now almost 3 years. So with that, Ben, that concludes my remarks for the state program. I'll give it back to you.
Sounds great, Chris. Thank you so much. David, thank you so much.
Thank you.
Phenomenal update. Great information. I think we've got some questions come in here, which we've had by email, and Antoine Reed is back to field those questions. Antoine, I'm going to turn it over to you for this this last part here of the Q&A.
Yes, thank you, Ben. One of the first questions was the question about flavors and cigars. We've seen, especially earlier today with the previous presentation, about the FDA focusing on flavors and products, especially combustible tobacco products. In your opinions, what should manufacturers kind of know or take into consideration when thinking about flavors in their products?
Well, why don't I take that first and then you can chime in, Chris. Obviously, you know, this issue is not going to go away. What we do have going on our side is that the FDA has said that they believe that tobacco or nicotine products should be treated on a continuum from the amount of harm that they do. Now, it's good that the FDA has recognized that. And the fact that normal use of cigars, you're not at any kind of increased health risk. So moderation in everything, in all things that we do, is something that we have going for us. And the fact that FDA has recognized this continuum, I think it gives us at least the ability to fight back using some of the FDA's own words. So obviously, it's always a threat. And as Chris has noted, you still have people at the local level that are going to, you know, attempt to ban our products. But, you know, fortunately, we've got a good team in place and we've got some very, very good arguments on our side.
Yeah. I don't have much to add to that, David, other than, you know, at the local level, it's less about the science. It's less about FDA. It's more about the emotion of the argument. It's the false narrative that because a product is flavored, it's overwhelmingly consumed by youth. And, you know, one of the things that we are constantly reminding lawmakers of is that, you know, for example, the age to purchase tobacco is now 21. And, you know, when you do things like the state of Massachusetts did by banning the sale of all flavored tobacco, you now have a very substantial black market thriving in the state of in the Commonwealth of Massachusetts. And the people that are selling illegally, they don't check IDs. They don't care. And so if they're selling to minors, you know, out of a backpack on the street. So, you know, things like that are what we remind policymakers of, especially at the state level. But it gets very difficult when you have, you know, politicians at the local level who are sometimes sitting in office for the very first time that are easily talked into appearing as if they're doing something good to protect kids. But it's a false narrative. The statistics don't show that youth usage of these products is is at all high, but it's more about, you know, the messaging. And so, you know, we continue to fight and try to keep the fight at the state level as best we can.
Yeah, you know, I might also add that we do have two very good studies right now on our side that have shown when you they banned tobacco or flavored vaping products in both San Francisco and Massachusetts, the underage use of regular cigarettes actually went up. So it really had the exact opposite effect. You know, oftentimes you can, you know, here in the United States, we have 50 states that are wonderful laboratories. Well, you know, we've done the experiments now, and they were colossal failures. So hopefully we'll have that on our side.
Another question that came up beforehand was the definition of premium cigars. It seems like we've been going back and forth on a federal level of what exactly is a premium cigar. And the importance of that definition is that some of the legislators are defining that definition will go on to kind of determine, I guess you could say, how different legislators or even the federal government handles premium cigars. So where is it? I mean, is there a kind of widely accepted definition of what makes a cigar premium? And where are we at with that whole debate?
Well, I have to say, I've been looking into this, and there seems to be several definitions of what exactly a premium cigar is, and that is clearly going to vary by locality. Yes, it would be good to have a single definition, and that's something that, you know, obviously we're going to be working on here in the future, but, you know, it's a wonderful question and a difficult one to answer.
I think Antoine, what I might add to that in the state work that we do, you know, the idea for a definition of premium cigar came about because of FDA regulation of the cigar industry. In the state level, there isn't that necessarily that consideration. What we address at the state level are issues related to taxation, regulation, sale, you know, that kind of thing. And so, you know, what we commonly find in a lot of places is that especially tax regulators want to be able to look at a product and know whether it fits the definition of what it is. When you start defining a product based upon how it's constructed, whether it's machine made, whether it's handmade, you know, whether you get into these things that aren't visible by looking at the product sitting on the shelf or holding in someone's hand, it gets very difficult to then define what something actually is with a definition written that way. You know what something weighs, pounds per thousand, that type of thing. But when it comes to trying to come up with a premium definition for a cigar at the state level, depending on the issue, it really becomes key. And so that's kind of, you know, what I'd offer up as far as how the idea of a premium cigar is treated for purposes other than FDA regulation.
Another big topic is the topic of PMTAs as they relate to premium cigars. The premium cigar industry, of course, had several, I would say, wins in that they were not subject to the PMTA process that ENDS products were. But I think there's a lot of confusion also in the industry in that people think you have some companies that kind of are still releasing new products. I don't know if they're really new or if they're kind of repackaged older blends that they're kind of bringing back to the market. But there's just a lot of confusion as to, is the threat of PMTAs and premium cigars over, or is it still on the horizon? And how should manufacturers kind of be preparing for whatever is about to come in terms of PMTAs?
Yeah, well, let me say, as long as the law is on the books, it's never over. Obviously, we did get a very, very big win when we were able to get most premium cigars to qualify under substantial equivalence so that you don't have to go through the PMTA process. But that doesn't guarantee that a new administrator or a new CTA director might not try to address that again and change that. You know, just as we're going to continuously face the issue of flavorings in cigars, I suspect we're always going to be at risk of somebody trying to, you know, change, you know, current regulations and in current rulings.
And we did have an audience question, which was, do you think people who vape could potentially switch to cigars? And I want to kind of reframe that question maybe as, do you think, especially since this is a trade show and business to business, do you think or do you see any indications in your work and when you're out in the field that any vape shops that may have been, you know, primarily focused on ends products, do you see indication that they might switch over to carrying more cigar products, or is it kind of not, you know, are they not willing to cross that aisle yet?
Well, it's always difficult to project what's in the consumer's mind. I have to say, when you look at vape products, they are primarily a nicotine delivery system. Whereas one smokes a cigar, it's a ritual. It's, you know, it's a celebratory ritual that one goes through. It's something you enjoy at the end of the day. I don't think people necessarily vape for the same reasons. So from that standpoint, I really don't see them as good substitutes for one another. And that's really why, when you look at the FDA, why they have that continuum of tobacco or nicotine products. And it's why cigars are on one end of the continuum and vape products are on another.
And a couple, I think maybe it was last week, or if it wasn't last week, it was a week before, I think the CAA had released data on cigar imports or exports. What kind of trends are you all seeing in terms of the cigars market, the cigar market in the U.S.?
Sure. I have to say it's very, very robust. We saw just incredible growth in 2021. And hopefully that growth can continue through 2022. We saw things, you know, we did see a little bit of a hiccup, I think, at the end in the last month of the data that we released. But I, from what I understand from a lot of our major vendor companies, look, they had the same supply issues that everyone else had. So a lot of that had to do with just the inability to get product into the United States. But the demand certainly looks like it's still there. So I'm very, very optimistic that we will be able to retain the gains that we enjoyed in 2021 and hopefully grow further in 2022.
And it's kind of a wrap-up question. Could you all just explain, I know for those people who may be watching this live or in playback mode, could you just explain what the Cigar Association is and what its primary focus is and how it kind of differs maybe from some of the other trade associations that other people might be familiar with?
Certainly. Well, the Cigar Association of America has been around since 1937. We're really the original cigar group. We represent all facets of the cigar industry. We represent manufacturers. We have a lot of wholesalers. We have a lot of suppliers, and we even have retailers. We represent all cigars. We represent premium cigars. We represent popular cigars. So we really represent the entire cigar industry. And as Chris has noted, we have an incredible state team. So we're in the states. We have, correct me if I'm wrong, Chris, a lobbyist in just about every state to handle state affairs, with Chris leading those efforts. We also have a large presence in D.C., where we have myself and various others that help us keep an eye on the Congress and you know, the Food and Drug Administration. So we really represent everybody, and we have a huge following across the country when it comes to how we're represented at the state level.
Yeah, David, just to add to that, you know, CAA is the only trade association that represents the interests of cigars that has lobbyists in 45 states. We cover all 50 state houses, and We've got people on the ground in 45 states all year long that are looking out for and representing the interests of not just cigar manufacturers, but also retailers and consumers. And so, you know, we've had that in place for many, many years now. There's no substitute for having people on the ground. It's why I spend, as Ben mentioned at the outset, roughly 200 days on the year traveling to go and meet up with people and advocate on behalf of not just our association, but the entire industry.
And if anybody is interested in joining, by all means, contact us. Everybody within the cigar world is certainly welcome. And we have various levels of membership that I'm sure almost anyone can afford. So I look forward to hearing from more folks.
And I guess as a final question, especially for those in the cigar industry, they always want to know, what's the latest on the ongoing cigar lawsuit? Because I think we haven't heard a really big update in a while. So what's going on with that?
The lawsuit is largely been adjudicated. There are just one or two areas that, to be honest with you, I've done a lot of reading of late, and that's not an area that I've dove into. Most of the areas of the lawsuit have been adjudicated. We just have one or two small issues that are still being looked at.
Awesome. Well, that's all of my questions, and we wanted to thank you both for coming on today and for sharing information with the cigar industry and the other industries. And we hope to see you all at TPE. And for those of you who have not yet registered for TPE, you can register for TPE 2022 at tobaccoplusexpo.com. This session and other TPE Ignite sessions can also be viewed at tobaccoplusexpo.com. This is the final session for today, but we do have a session tomorrow, which is also cigar related. It's going to be Sisters of the Leaf Part 2. So it's an all women's panel, and they're going to be talking about cigars and topics pertaining to women and women smoking cigars and women who are working actually in the industry. So we're really excited about that panel and hope you all will tune in to watch that at 12 p.m. Eastern time tomorrow. So at noontime, lunchtime, it'll be a great session. So thank you again for you all for coming on here. And for anybody who wants to view the session later, or you came in later, it'll be on YouTube, and it'll also be on Facebook on the Tobacco Plus Expo page. And we'll be sharing it throughout tobacco business. So thank you so much. And we hope for everyone to join us tomorrow for the next session. Bye.
Thanks again.
Thank you, everyone. Thank you, Ben.